Hello. All of us talk about Vedic astrology, but today let us try to understand what are the different streams of Vedic astrology. In ancient India, Vedic astrology was a part of Vedic studies. And everyone who went to Gurukul used to study this astrology as a part of their studies. Even today, there are few Gurukuls still existing in India, where, Brahminic culture and all the Vedas and Upanishads are taught. And the same thing is followed even today. Even these children, they learn astrology as a part of their studies. See, in those days, the knowledge of the Jyotisha would have been mainly for guiding the kings and chieftains and society in general. So obviously, the focus would have been on mundane astrology that predicted major events and in general, and every king had an expert astrologer in his court who guided on when events like when to declare war or would I be able to be successful in war and what would be the status of crops and plants in the country, what would be the economy, future of country, and what would be the effect of eclipses and, which direction the enemies might attack. Even for the king, the main Rani Patrani, Patrani they used to call the main queen, from which direction she should I select so that I get luck. So all these were the questions of the kings, which were solved by the astrologers. They wouldn't do any important event without taking the muhurat and without consulting an astrologer. So later on, this science of Vedic astrology diversified, and the study of individual horoscopes also gained prominence, because every one of us want to know what holds for us in future. So the Vedanga Jyotisha is one of the earliest texts on astronomy embedded inside the Vedas only. Okay, so Jyotisha is one of the Vedangas. The word Anga, Veda we know, Anga means a part. Preferably, we use it always for body parts. Anyway, so Vedanga means actually it is a supplementary discipline. So how many supplementary disciplines are there for that? We have six such supplementary disciplines. One of them is Jyotisha. All right, all these six Vedangas support the Vedic rituals. Now, Vedic astrology, thus, has got three main streams. The first one is Samhita Shastra, then Hora Shastra, and Siddhanta Shastra. Now let us try and understand these terms one by one. So the word Samhita means bring together or union or compile together. So we will take the meaning of compile together. Okay. So actually it is Samhitas are the oldest or the most ancient texts, which are nothing but compilation of hymns and prayers and rituals and divination and prophecy. So these are actually very vast. They include something like, Swapna Shastra. So Swapna Shastra is very interesting. I have read, I have a book on that actually. And Swapna Shastra, they say, morning dreams, and if you dream of a particular thing, what does it imply? Because the faith here is our subconscious mind knows each and everything. Consciously, we are not able to recollect anything, but subconscious mind knows not just our previous life also, and so many lives, whatever we have lived, that remains. That is the faith. Okay, so Swapna Shastra has got a detailed account. And some they also say, if you're not feeling well or if you're napping in the afternoon, if such dreams are there, that's only a mental hallucination, that they have no meaning. See the study and observation what our seers have done. And they also say early in the morning, say around in the Brahma Muhurta, if you get a dream and that is telling you something, that is giving you some signal. So I can go on and Swapna Shastra, but I want to tell you all other things also. There is something also called as Shakuna Shastra. I have a book on that also. This Shakuna Shastra is some nowadays, you know, people say it is all superstition. Like, what is this? Like, o billi ne rasta kata. The cat is going ahead and then the work doesn't happen. See, one thing what we have to remember is life in those days was simple and they used to observe a lot and then write something about it. We can't rubbish. Today, we don't have patience to test or patience to think about those things because we are messed up in so many things because, you know, we have diversified our mind and we engage our mind totally into different aspects. Anyway, they use the omens and observation around us to come to some conclusions and they did. So, analysis of dreams or fantasies, I already spoke about. There is also something based on the sounds of the animals, you know, or cries of animals. The one may be like commonly known to you, like a wall lizard. If it, you know, if it makes a sound once or twice, what does it mean in the morning, in the evening, when the guests have come? So what does it indicate? And when the dogs cry or, and so on and so forth, you know. And like then planetary movement also is included in that because that we have to know that then only. And muscle twitching. This is another interesting thing. Muscle twitching, people say, you know, if your muscle on the right shoulder, you know, just makes once it just gets into the twitching. So what happens? And then the eyes also, like eyelids, left eyelid twitching is good for ladies, right eye sweating is bad for ladies, so on and so forth. So they are very interesting. I read it for the sake of knowledge. So how much we imply and how much we discover, but I'm very fond of getting the knowledge about these things. That's why I thought I'll say. So, for example, you know, Brihat Samhita explains such things in great detail. And it is used for prediction and divination as well, not just all these things. Okay. It also covers the topics like eclipses, then prediction of rain, the condition of growth of crops and plants, and matrimony, and, you know, and horoscope matching and everything comes in that. Or based on your horoscope, what kind of a partner you are going to get, whether you are going to get a good guy or a bad guy or a good girl or a bad girl, or what are the remediation, all that thing is compiled in that. And general well-being of a nation, and then, you know, its relation with the world and neighboring countries and enemies, and use of gemstones. Use of gemstones also is so widely discussed in our shastras. Say, for example, and also what metal you have to use for a stone is very important. See, people go to an astrologer, unfortunately, it is like people just learn something and they start practicing. They themselves have no proper idea. And people are, they misguide others who consult them, misguide the clients, let me say. Because you should never, ever wear the gemstones of Dusthanas. What are Dusthanas? Like, you know, 6, 8 and 12. It will enhance bad effects. But I have seen some people who come to me, they say this was suggested by an astrologer. I would say, okay, I don't want to comment on anybody's knowledge. What you do is you keep this away from yourself, not even in your cupboard. You keep it somewhere else in the house where you're not often using. Say for like, you know, say 6 months and then see the result if you feel any improvement. That way I tell. I can't say other person is wrong and all that. Nobody is an expert in astrology. It's a very wise thing with all due respect to everybody. Anyway, say for example, if we are want to use a pearl, the pearl should never be set in gold. It has to be set in silver. Because why we say that? Pearl represents moon. Moon is Chandrama Manaso Jataha. So he is a karaka for our mind. And Surya is a prakhar. The gold represents Surya. So if you set moon in Surya, the power of moon, our mind gets completely clogged. I mean, you won't get the proper result. That is the thing, you know. This I'm talking again. See, I have also got a lot of sets of, we all make sets of, you know, pearl necklaces and pearl earrings and everything in gold. That's fine. When we suggest astrologically, when you want to wear it on your fingers with the intention of correcting or remediation of your grahas or planets, you should be very careful. All these rules apply. Otherwise, you can wear anything. All right. Then mundane astrology also comes from Samhita. So, I'll be making a separate video again on mundane astrology to explain that. Otherwise, it will become very big. So there are a few samhitas, like, you know, there is the Bhrigu Samhita written by Maharshi Bhrigu, then Brihatpa Samhita written by Varahamihira Acharya, and then there is Ravana Samhita. Many people do not know, Ravan was a great Shiva Bhakta and he was a great astrologer and he was a great, you know, musician also. He was very talented, Ravan. But, you know, he was a negative energy, bundle of negative energy. And completely opposite of Prabhu Sri Ramchandra. So, Ravana Samhita, the text is available. People have translated in different languages and all that. But honestly speaking, I have not read it because my father also had a passion for astrology. He was into the law and judiciary department. He was a criminal lawyer by profession. But he had great passion for astrology. He had lot of books. That's how my interest developed, you know. He had lot of books and he used to call for a lot of astrological magazines. One of them was Sir B.V. Raman's magazine. What a great astrologer Sri B.V. Raman was. And I used to stealthily read them as a child also. I wouldn't understand much, like, you know, when I was growing up, but I would read it. So that's how my interest developed. Anyway, my father mentioned to me that you should not read or practice Ramana Samhita because it is a bundle of negative energy. And I have kept word, I haven't read, though it is available, the books are available, PDF are available. I have not read it. He said it doesn't bring good luck or you shouldn't even prophesize using that to anybody and not for your own self also. So frankly, I have not read that. And apart from the Ravana Samhita, then there is also something called as Narada Samhita, written by Maharshi Narad. Many people may not know Narad Muni was also an astrologer. And he extensively deals with Mahurat. I have a book, but I haven't completely read it. I am in the process of reading through. Because this is so vast, I have collected a lot of books, but I keep on reading. One life, I feel, is not enough. We do so many things, and then whatever time remains, I devote for astrology. So that's how the pace is. Not all that great as I would want. I would want it 24/7, but I'm a householder. It is not possible. So, anyway, now the next stream I'm going to talk about is Hora Shastra. Okay, it deals, Hora Shastra actually deals with interpretations and predictions of the horoscope and the study of individual horoscopes, you know. So, like, you know, events in one's life. It also speaks about the previous life and future life. See, what happens is, one thing we need to understand. Many people say again, oh, who knows who has seen the future life and who has seen the past life. Buddhism also believes a lot in, reincarnations and soul being born, Atma being born again and again, and even Hinduism. All right. Now, if one thing you just try to use your logic, at one particular time, maybe let us take a business tycoon, Dhirubhai Ambani. When Dhirubhai Ambani was born, there will be thousands or millions of children on this earth who would have born in the same graha combination. Then why are they not getting the same result? Everyone is not becoming super rich, right? This is where the karma or our past life deeds come to a picture. It is karma, theory of karma is like, you know, accumulation. There are different varieties of karmas again. You know, Sanchita karma is something what you have accumulated. It's like our bank balance. Until and unless I earn something and put in the bank, I can't withdraw and, you know, spend that money. It is exactly like that. So that is where the things have come, you know, like as you sow, so you reap, or, you know, whatever you do and it comes back to you. Life is a boomerang, you know, it will always come back. So whatever you give comes back to you. So these are all the things based on the theory of karma. So we believe in past life. So there is a detailed account of past life also. If you study this past life, about past life in the Vedic astrology, you can actually, it's mind-blowing. I have done some research on this and have compared the horoscopes also. In the family only we get, no? We are all actually in the family when we are born or, you know, getting married to somebody or whatever, those kind of things. We are all kind of group souls. We make an arrangement, we make an agreement to come into this life and do. I'll tell you one more thing. If there is a bad marriage, or if a person divorces, or he doesn't divorce you, he troubles you throughout your life, this was your Atma had an agreement with that Atma before you came on this earth. This many of us don't realize. We keep on cursing, we keep on cursing. See, internally, we are only superficially looking at the things. Oh, she is troubling me, he is troubling me, whatever, whatever. But inside, like, you know, what has happened in the past, what is buried inside your mind, you are not able to discover, or you are not able to understand. That is where anybody who troubles you, it could be a bad colleague at the office, or it could be your own family member. And there are people who play games right, left and center, like, you know, they are power hungry. They can't tolerate you. They just want to replace you, or they just want to, you know, shatter your image. Whatever, all these kind of things. This is all a theory of karma. Whatever you are given, either you had done something wrong to that Atma, and that Atma is finishing this off now. Nullifying whatever he or she had suffered. Actually, Atma has no gender, but I'm just using for the thing. Or that Atma in this life is accumulating bad karma. It is, that's all. Either you are paying off your things, or you are collecting the punya or pap, whatever you say. Either it is good karma or bad karma. That is the theory of karma. All right. And there is something called as Tajik Shastra also. Tajik Shastra talks about annual horoscope or Varshafala. What is going to happen to the country in the next 1 year? What is, or to the world in next 1 year? Or what will be the sketch of 1 year span for an individual? So that all comes in Tajik Shastra. And there is also Prashna Shastra or Horary Astrology. And KP, it's popularly now known as KP Paddhati, that is Krishnamurti Paddhati. This is really amazing. I'll be talking about it more because I have studied KP Paddhati and it is really, really fascinating. You should believe to study it. And Varaha Miracharya has written Brihad Jatakajya, the Hora Shastra. It is very extensive. I have a book which runs to 1128 pages. He has included possibly everything we want to know, different yogas and separate this thing, basic astrology and different grahaka combination. He has also one small part on Stri Jataka Prakaranam, but actually female horoscopy is a subject in itself, but he has included a chapter in that. Even Brihat Parashara Hora Shastra, this was compiled by Maharshi Parashara. Those who know the epics of Ramayana and Mahabharata will be knowing. If you know epic of Mahabharata, you will be knowing about Sri Vedavyasa, who composed Mahabharata. Okay, the father of this Vedavyasa is Parashara. So Maharshi Parashara and Matsya Gandhi story is very famous. So they gave birth to a son who became Vedavyasa Maharshi, Maharshi Vedavyasa. Okay, he has documented Mahabharata. So actually, Brihat Parashara Hora Shastra was written by Maharshi Parashara. This is very widely accepted work in Vedic astrology, and you must explore this. You know, there are many branches of Hora Shastra actually. So I will be making a separate video on Hora Shastra so that you will get some glimpse into it. Now the next one I'm going to discuss is Siddhanta Shastra. See, Siddhanta is actually a kind of a theory, or it come, or proof, proving some theory, I would say like that. Okay. Now, Siddhanta Shastra is all about mathematics and the calculation of the moments of the planets, their latitude, their longitude, and their position in the horizon, and the ephemeris. The entire Panchanga is, created using the Siddhanta Shastra. So it is an astronomical basis of astrology. I can put it that way. So Panchanga is purely based on mathematical calculations and for casting any horoscope, whether it is an individual horoscope or a mundane horoscope, we require sufficient knowledge of this. One such renowned work is Surya Siddhanta This was written in as early as 4th or 5th century CE. And this text has been mentioned extensively and quoted in the 6th century CE text from Varahamihiracharya. Nowadays, actually, you know, like we have a lot of our calculation and casting the horoscope and everything. We have a lot of progress, like we have softwares. So now nobody sits with the Panchanga. When I learned way back in 30 years back, or when I got into astrology, I used to make the horoscopes manually. That itself would take. Actually, I took a course. I had sufficient knowledge about prediction part, but I didn't know how to, you know, actually cast a horoscope. So for that, I took a formal course of 2 years. First year was only this Siddhanta Shastra about mathematical part. How to cast a horoscope and how to, you know, check the things, check the ephemeris and Lyra's table of, you know, all those things, those kind of things. So 1 year that was. And second year it was prediction. And then I, you know, I kept on studying. It is a continuous study. As I said, for Jyotisha Shastra, one lifetime is not enough. You have to do it over and over again. And also they say the only thing what you carry, the Atma carries from this world is the knowledge. So we will talk, maybe someday I will talk about past life and all these kind of things. Then I will elaborate on about that. So this text, particularly Surya Siddhanta, is a puzzle. It's a big puzzle to the contemporary scientist. And it is, you know, is famous for the number of the first established debate theory on Earth being spherical. See, we give credit to the Western world, but our people knew that the Earth is round and all the grahas, they are, going around the sun in different orbits. All this knowledge comes in astronomy, right? And also, our ancient mathematicians have spoken about calculus and trigonometric function. So that is the power of our culture and this Jyotisha Shastra. I hope I have provided enough information about this. So the next video I will be making on different streams of Hora Shastra, because that is also very nice to know. And then I will begin with my mundane astrology series. If you like the video, please share and subscribe to my channel. Thank you so much. God bless.